my power to save. Then in a nobler, sweeter song, I'll sing thy power to
Dana. Welcome to our gathering. If you're watching from home, welcome to Ballardsville Online. At our church, we want everyone to experience Jesus, engage with others, and embrace the commission. Wherever you are, don't just be a spectator. Be an active participant in our experience today. If this is your first time with us, or if you haven't had the chance yet, please fill out the digital Connect card. You can find it at bbclife.org/connectcard. In fact, just go ahead and get it done right now while this video is playing. Thank you. During this coronavirus season, we are doing all we can to make our church family safe when we are in person. We have now opened up the Fellowship Hall as a mask-only venue for those who don't yet feel comfortable being in the auditorium. The music and message are streamed live on video with a live worship leader there too. If you're headed there, you may use the office side doors to enter. We continue to provide an online portal for your offerings at bbclife.org/give or text BBCGIVE to 73256. If you have an envelope with you today, you can drop it in one of the boxes on the wall at the rear of the auditorium. Do you want to give blood and help save lives? Tomorrow, November 16th, we will be hosting a blood drive in the Fellowship Hall from 1 to 6 p.m. Go to redcrossblood.org and enter sponsor code Ballardsville Baptist to register. The Advent season is upon us, and we still plan to have a special music celebration on December 6th and the Living Nativity drive-through event on December 12th. Choir rehearsals begin tonight at 6 and will be held in the auditorium to achieve safe distance. We welcome anyone 7th grade and above who enjoys singing to join us. Volunteer for the Living Nativity by going to bbclife.org/events. This is just some of what's going on at Ballardsville. Once again, you are all welcome with us today. No exceptions. Jesus is alive and waiting with forgiveness and power to meet with you and all of us today.
Good morning. Good morning. Wherever you're at this morning, in the room or online, can I invite you all to stand to your feet, please? Let's prepare to worship the King. This morning, what we're about is a man named Yeshua who lived about 2,000 years ago. He was a Jewish man, and we know him by the name of Jesus in our modern language. But this man was a poor, simple man from the countryside, from really kind of nowhere. But he's changed the world. He's changed my life. He's changed many of our lives. And I've seen it happen. We're here to worship him today. Online participants this morning, he may have changed you, but he wants to change all of us and continue to do it. And that's what this morning is about. And the thing is, this man died. He died the most horrible death, not deserved. At the hands of men, he died on a Roman cross. But then 3 days later, he did what no other human being has ever done. He was raised from the dead, was resurrected. He changed history. And again, he's changed my life. He's changed many of your lives. Amen? Amen. Yeah, give him praise this morning. That is what we're about. Praise God. We're about Jesus and that his resurrection after his crucifixion has changed our lives and changed history. It is the biggest headline that has ever been and could be in any newspaper or any TV screen. It is the headline. It's changed everything. It is why I'm smiling today. It is why you are smiling. And that's why we gather to worship, because our lives are not the same because of that man, Jesus. Jesus, the Messiah. So because he lives, life is not the same. We are forgiven. We are free. It's good to be reminded about that. And like many people across the world are lifting up the word hallelujah. hallelujah to Jesus this morning. Let's join our voices with them, would you? Sing with me.
God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives.
Lift this up.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives,
wherever you are,
all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
Sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Sing it out.
You have won the victory. Hallelujah. You have won it all for me.
Sing death could not.
By his stripes we are healed. By his nail-pierced hands we're free. By his blood we're washed clean. Now we have the victory. And the power of sin is broken. Jesus overcame it all.
It all. Yes, he has.
He has won our freedom.
Jesus has.
Jesus has won it all.
And why?
Death could not hold you down.
No, it couldn't. Nothing could hold you.
You are the risen King.
Yes, he is, church. He is. Sing this.
Seated in
majesty. You are
the risen King.
Oh, it's so good. It's so good. One more time.
Death could not.
Been well.
You are the risen King.
My King, sing it.
Seated in majesty.
Every voice this morning.
You are the risen.
That's right.
King.
Watch this.
Our God is risen.
Oh, he's alive.
He is alive.
Yes, he's alive.
He won the victory.
Yes, he's alive.
He reigns on high.
That's it, sing it.
Our God is risen.
Oh.
He is alive.
He
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he. justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into revival. Lord, lead us back to you.
So come,
I'm moving this place.
Let justice roll on like a river. The worship turn into revival.
Bring us back.
Lord, lead us back to you.
Back to our first love.
Justice roll on.
Back to our first love. Back to our first love, Lord.
The worship turn into revival. Lord, lead us back to you.
We need that. Need that
one last
this
time. So come, move, let justice roll on like a river. Let worship turn into revival. Lord, lead us back to you.
Be seated. This time, kids, ages from above, can go on to Kids Zone or Discovery Club. If you're watching online, you can fill out a Connect card at bbclife.org/connectcard, or if you are here in person, you can fill one of those out as well in the kiosk in the back. Let's move. Let's give ourselves to God and allow Him to move through us. We are the vessels by which He does what we just asked for.
The signs, the seven signs that Jesus uses to awaken true followers. And so I have a question for you today. It's kind of a question that you can think about, you can talk about with your family, or even talk about in your groups as you meet throughout the week. And that question is this. Why would Jesus say, I have to eat his flesh and drink his blood? Now, if you're like just turning on and you've never been in church before, or you're like, just tuning in on the website or something and you've never kind of heard what we're going to be talking about today, you're going to think, what a crazy question this is, and you might be tempted to tune out. Don't do that. Because Jesus knows how important food is to us. And so He's using food to help us understand how we are to desire Him. But I want you to talk about, it's multi-layered. There's many things. So talk about that. Now listen, I like to eat. Does anyone here like to eat? Okay, everybody put your hands down. Does anyone not like to eat? Okay, that's what I thought. We all like to eat, right? And I like to eat certain types of foods. And that is almost everything except sweet potatoes. But really, I like to eat foods that taste good. There's just like, why would you eat foods that taste bad? And there's so many. It's like, till we run out of good tasting foods that we have to eat broccoli and cauliflower all the time? It's like, and so I like to eat good foods. I think we have an eating gene in our family. Because I come from a long line of eaters, and we're really good at it, and we do it several times throughout the day. when my youngest son was really young, he, I mean, this was probably 5 or 6 years ago, so he's 12 now. He was probably 5 or 6 years old. He said, Dad, he just come to me, unprovoked. Dad, the problem is I need more taste in my mouth. That was just out of the blue. He just come up and confessed, my problem, I need more taste in my mouth. Yeah, and I'm like, I get that. That's kind of like, I think that's why we're all there. So we like to eat. And you've heard the expression, you are what you eat, right? Have you ever heard that? That means if we eat broccoli and cauliflower, we're going to be green and look like a brain. If we eat steak and potatoes, you're going to look a little bit more like this. But the truth is that what you eat does influence how you live. It influences your health. It influences your ability. A lot of research shows that the things that we're eating are actually killing us, and eating less is actually better for us because of all the chemicals and things and the processed foods and those such things like that. So I'm not here to try to convince you on going on something like that. All I'm here is trying to do is to say there is a relationship between our desire and need for food, physical food, and what we eat being good for us or bad for us, and our relationship with Christ and how we desire Him and how that relationship is good for us. And the main point today is this. It is that to go all in with Jesus, I must let Jesus all in me. I think many times we make Jesus compete for places in our heart. I know I do. There's times in my life where, you know, I don't let Jesus all in. He's competing for my attention. Like sometimes, you know, doesn't your phone, where's my phone? It's in there. There's my mask. All right. Does your phone get more of your attention than Jesus? I'm going to say, yeah, probably. And the games and all that. And I don't know if there's anything wrong with some games and a little bit of entertainment, but what's competing for our heart? What's competing for our desire? What is it? A few weeks ago, I was praying, and I was in my morning quiet time, and my phone buzzed. It just kind of dinged. And I normally have it set to do not disturb up until 9 o'clock, so all this is done, but I was running late this day, so I'm in my quiet time. And I stopped my prayer, and I checked my phone. And I was like, man. How many times throughout my day would I stop whatever I'm doing and check with the Lord? But as soon as that thing dings or buzzes or whatever it is your thing does, we stop and we check it. And so much so that we're actually upset with people who don't check it immediately and get back with us. Because my wife, I love her, I didn't ask permission. She just doesn't check her phone when it dings. And so I'm like sending 45 texts. Hey, where are you? Why are we buying a phone if you're not going to answer? Blah, blah, blah. You know, just you know, calling 7 times in a row. And she's like, well, I heard it ringing, but I was in the other room. No, you go check it. You respond immediately. That's what texts are for. It's immediate, constant communication. But I think we have divided hearts. And this series about going all in is about removing that division and placing, if you will, a betting analogy. All of our chips, placing our whole body, our whole life into Christ and letting Him bring His whole self in to us. In the book of Revelation, Jesus is writing through John to the seven churches. And in one place he says, hey, you guys are lukewarm. You're not hot. You're just lukewarm. You're just one foot in the world and one foot in the church. And he's like, repent. Come back to me. Another place he says, you've lost your first love. Return to your first love. And it's like, you know, Is Jesus my first love? Am I lukewarm? Are you lukewarm? And this whole series about going all in is to try to bring us back to Christ, to cause that revival. And I don't care where you are in your walk. You may be someone who's just learning about Jesus for the first time. You may be someone who's been walking with Christ for 40, 50, 60, 70, 80 or more years. There's always room to go further in. There's always places in our life that he's wanting to illuminate and wanting to fill those places, those vacuums. And he always calls us to repent and come back to him. I want us to remember the purpose that John, we're in the book of John, the reason he wrote his book is found in John chapter 20. It's in verses 30 and 31. It says, Jesus performed this, so this is the reason that John, the apostle, wrote his book. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. And this, the reason he wrote about these seven signs that we're studying is so that we would believe that Jesus is the promised one. That all throughout history, since the fall of man, God has been operating a redemptive purpose to bring about to fruition the redemption of mankind, to save us from our sin, to forgive us of our sin, and to restore a relationship with him that has been broken. And because our relationship with him has been broken, then we go off and do our own things because we have divided hearts and we're lukewarm and we've left our first love and those sorts of things, we end up trying to do life without him. And that's when we make mistakes. And that's when things go horribly wrong. And that just leads to brokenness and brokenness and brokenness. And God promised that he's going to send someone that's going to defeat Satan, is going to restore us to right relationship with the Father. And that word used for that is the Messiah, or the Christ, the anointed one. And so he says, wait, the reason he wrote this, so you would believe that, and that he's the Son of God. And being the Son of God, like for some people, the Jews and even Muslims, they think because we believe in God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, we believe in three gods, and that is just not true. We believe there's one God and one God only. We'll point that out a little bit later on. But God reveals himself to us in such a way as there is a Son, and he's distinct from the Father, and he serves the Father, and he lives to bring about redemption for us. God reveals himself to us in such a way that there is a Holy Spirit, that is God's presence, that can live inside of you, helping you know how to live your life all in for Jesus. And so when we say Son of God, that's what he's talking about, that he is indeed God himself. And the Jewish people knew that. Anytime Jesus claimed to be the Son of God or say that God was his Father, they would get mad and want to kill him because they're like, you're making yourself equal with God. You're saying that you're God if you're the Son of God. And they wanted to kill him for it. And then that by believing this, that he is the Messiah, the King, the Anointed One, that believing he is God, that by believing this, we would have life in his name. And that life is that life starts now. It's not just something, some future reality that's going to occur in heaven. It is a life that starts now. It's a new way of living. It's a way of seeing things and processing things and understanding things that now things kind of make a little bit more sense. And to have joy and hope in the middle of difficult times. Well, today's sign is the only miracle that's recorded other than the resurrection. It's the only miracle recorded in all four Gospels. Does anyone know what it is? What sign, what miracle is recorded in all four Gospels other than the resurrection? Feeding of the 5,000. And Jesus feeds 5,000 men, not counting women and children, and where men would be, women would be, and where women would be, children would be. And the estimates are this was a group of probably 20,000 people. One of the other gospel writers, not John, tells us that the women and children were there. And so he's going to take five loaves, and they're not like huge loaves. They're not like French baguettes. You know, they'd be small, probably like maybe Olive Garden size maybe a little less. They could be round. I've seen them depicted as round, but they're not huge. Five loaves and then two small fish that were probably dried out or pickled so that they would not spoil. And so there's a story behind that with Magdala and Mary Magdalene and where they were and what their main business was in that area, but we don't have time for that. So we're in John chapter 6, and we're starting in verse 1. Now look, so I'm going to be moving. I'm going to read some from the first part of John 6 and then some from the last part of John 6. And we're going to go back and forth. So we're going to be bouncing around. So try to follow along so you don't get lost. So I'm going to read from the miracle, and then Jesus gives what they call a discourse or a sermon about him being the bread of life, and that happens in the latter part of John chapter 6. And so we're going to be going to some of those verses and going back and forth. And so this is what it says in John chapter 6, verse 1. It says, sometime after this, Jesus crossed the far shore of the Sea of Galilee, that is the Sea of Tiberias. So he crossed over there. The last time we saw him, he was in Jerusalem. Now he's back in Galilee, which is north of Jerusalem. This is kind of his hometown, the base of operations. And this is kind of where he hung out most of the time because the Jews wanted to kill him. And so this is why he would always retreat back to this area around Galilee to do a lot of his work. The second verse says, a great crowd of people followed him because they saw the signs he had performed by healing the sick. The great crowd is the 5,000 plus women and children. And then verse number 3 says that then Jesus went up on a mountainside and sat down with his disciples. Now, here's the reason. And if you look at the other accounts, what's going on is this great crowd of people have been following Jesus and his disciples for some time. And he's been doing all of this healing and all this thing. And one of the other accounts, it's either Matthew or Mark, tells us that they didn't even have a chance to eat. They were so tired. They were so worn out. They're actually trying to get away from the crowds for a little bit and have a little bit of a retreat for themselves so that they can regroup, so that they can talk, so that they can even eat. And so here is this great crowd coming up to them. And it says, you know, Jesus went up with to sit down with his disciples. And then in verses number 26 and 27, further down in the chapter, it tells us this. He says that Jesus answered these people. So he's telling these people, you're looking for me very truly, or truly, truly, or I tell the truth, very truly, I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw the signs that I performed, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. You see, what he's saying here is that the reason for following him, the reason that the crowds were just going after him, was because of physical needs, temporal physical needs. Now, some of you've been like on the other side of the world, like it's out of America. When I went to Indonesia, not in the main cities, but we finally went out and we got on these islands, there are people living in this like Gilligan's Hut. I mean, and you know what their main concern is every day? Anybody? What are you going to eat? That's it. They have fire. They can purify their water. What are you going to eat? And that's it. They have a hut over here. They're living on the ocean. It is paradise. The only thing they've got to worry about is what are you going to eat today? And can I get this fire going to clean the water? That's it. Until they get sick, of course. And then, you know, that's why we go over and help and tell them about Jesus. But nevertheless, it's a physical need that compelled, and these people would have been similar. You know, they didn't have air conditioning, refrigeration, electricity like we have. It's like, where are you getting your next meal? And so they got into this habit of looking for how their physical needs were going to be filled, and their whole life was about filling their own personal physical needs. And we call those felt needs, things that you feel. What's gonna help you? And so all of their momentum towards Jesus was about fulfilling physical needs. Now, that's okay in the beginning, but it's very incomplete. It's very incomplete. Because Jesus, although he does heal us sometimes physically, and although he does miracles and heals people physically, and he did that in that day, and while he calls us to meet people's physical needs and care for the widows and the poor and the orphans and to show them love, it's all for the purpose of showing a greater love, a greater need, a spiritual need, something that goes far beyond the physical. Because it doesn't matter how much food you eat, and even if you have a constant supply of it like we do today, you're going to die. And you're going to face your maker. And you're got a problem, or you have a problem when you do that. And that's because we've all rebelled against God. And that's why we need a redeemer. That's why we need someone to help us. And so all of this physical talk is really pointing to a spiritual reality. The physical is important. Jesus took care of the physical. We're going to see that. But it points to something greater. Brokenness. Brokenness that we all experience, and those felt needs that we have, they are important, but they're not the real need. The real need. Because it doesn't matter if you're the richest person on the planet or the poorest person on the planet. It doesn't matter if you can dress in the finest suits and drive the finest cars, or you're walking around naked or in a loincloth and you have no transportation. One day, we're all going to stand the same place and must give an account for our lives. And the only way we can give an account is if we have Jesus. The only thing that God will accept is our belief, our dependence, our reliance upon what His Son has done for us. And so that brings us to our first point. And that is, to let Jesus all in me, I must change my motives. You see, a lot of times I live my life just like everyone else. I'm trying to meet my felt needs. What's going to make me happy? What's going to give me some more money? What's going to, you know, bring me joy? And maybe that's happy. You know, what's going to make me feel good? What's going to help me in the future? What's going to, I'm living my life. And I dare say most of us are. We're living our lives in order to have satisfaction and in this world and have all of our physical needs met. What happens is, just like the people that Jesus was talking to, that's oftentimes the only reason we come to Jesus. We come to Jesus when our life is broken and He wants us to. We come to Jesus when we have problems. He wants us to. But when He fixes those problems for us, many times people walk away. And when He doesn't fix those problems for us, many times people walk away. Because He says, come to me. I'll help you. I'll show you. I'll be with you in the midst of your hard time. He won't fix everything. But what He'll do is He'll help you live through it. And He'll give you hope in the midst of it, because this world is temporary and it's passing away. And so think about your life. Like, what are your motives? Like, why do you do what you do? And are the motives of my life more towards letting Jesus consume me, or more towards me being consumed by, or me consuming the world? And we're all really good at consuming things, right? I mean, we're Americans. We're probably the best consumers on the planet. Wouldn't you say? Is this, yeah, we consume. And so we're really good at consuming. So am I busy consuming, my motives consuming things that are temporal, that'll pass away, that really don't mean things, that lead to brokenness, that destroy my relationships, that steal my time on this earth with family and friends? Am I busy pursuing those things? Is that my motive? Or am I busy consuming Christ and becoming like Him and sharing what He's done, which is eternal, is what we will see. And that's what Jesus says in the chapter. He says, do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you, for on Him God the Father has placed His seal of approval. That is His Spirit, that is His authority, as we're going to see in just a second. It's like, don't be motivated by food that spoils. Food is our most basic need, right? We've already established, if you're living on an island naked in Indonesia, you're still going to be looking for food. That's your basic need. Food, water, that's it. Shelter. But he's like, why are you working? Why are you spending all of your motivation and energy, your life, on things that are going to rot, that's going to spoil, that's going to go away, rather work for food that endures to eternal life. And then he goes on to talk about the Son of Man. What is that? Daniel, the book of Daniel, is where we get this idea of the Son of Man. And this is what Daniel says. It's in other places in the Old Testament. But this is when Jesus uses the title Son of Man. It's his favorite title for himself. It comes from Daniel 7, 13 and 14. It says, Daniel says, in my vision at night I looked, and there before me was one like a Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. And then he says, he was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All nations and all peoples of every language worshiped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed. So when Jesus says, the Son of Man, that's what he's talking about. Look at it. He's given authority. He's been given a glory. He's been given sovereign power. He's been given just everything, even the nations of the earth, all nations, every tongue, every tribe are going to worship him. And he deserves it. That's what has been given to him. And so that's within the context of what we're talking about. Jesus says, work for me, the food that doesn't spoil. Work for me. And so now we go back to John 6, 4. Go back up to 4. He tells us that the Passover festival was near. Small little insert. Says that the Passover is coming up soon. This would probably be Jesus' second Passover. A year from this Passover that's coming soon would be when he dies on a cross and raises again. What's the Passover? The Passover is this idea where God called Pharaoh to let the children of Israel go, the tribes of Israel go. Pharaoh was treating them as slaves in Egypt, and they were not allowed to go worship God, so God raised up Moses. Moses goes into Pharaoh. Pharaoh doesn't listen to Moses, so God sends plagues to try to convince Pharaoh to let the Israelites go. And finally, God says, enough is enough. I'm sending the death angel, and the firstborn of every son in all the land will be taken in every family unless you have a provision. And the provision was a lamb. And so each family was to take a lamb, and they were to slaughter that lamb, and they were to put the blood above the doorpost and on the lintels. And so when the death angel passed over, he would see the blood, and he would pass over that house. That house would be spared the judgment that was coming for rejecting God. Okay, that's what was happening. And that lamb, they were supposed to eat all of it. The idea is that they would eat every single bit of it. They'd leave none to mourning. And if anything was left, they were to have burned it. They would even share it with their neighbors and if people couldn't afford one. But that was the deal. God made a way. That's the Passover. Moses then leads them all out into the wilderness. They're all hungry. They're like, why don't you bring us out in the wilderness to die? There's no food in the desert. I mean, what are we going to eat? Cactus and lizards? I mean, you know, every time you try to catch a lizard, the tail pops off, so that's gross. And so they're complaining, they're grumbling, and God sends something down called manna from heaven. Every morning there was manna there, and that manna would lay on the ground, and they were to go collect enough for that day only. If they collected enough for 2 days, the second day would spoil. And so it would not last overnight. Every morning there was a fresh supply. And that was true every day except for on the sixth day they could collect 2 days' worth because God said you can rest on the Sabbath, which is the seventh day. You don't have to go collect. And so that is the backdrop for everything that is happening here. And so on in verse number 5, he says this. When Jesus looked up, he saw the great crowd coming towards him, and he said to Philip, where shall we buy bread for these people? So Jesus is using the situation with all these people coming They're hungry. They're on this mountain to get away from these people. And because they're hungry, and he asked Philip. Philip was from that location, Bethsaida. Bethsaida is where he was from. Probably why Jesus asked Philip, hey, you know any supermarkets around where we can get food for 20,000 people? And, you know, what are we going to do about this? And again, it's a lot of people. In Mark 6:34, Mark tells us that Jesus had compassion on the people. He loved them. He knew that they had a need, but he's going to use this need to point them towards their greatest need. And so he says, he asked this only to test him, for already he had in his mind what he was going to do. And then Philip answered him. He said, it would take more than a half a year's wages to buy enough bread for each one to have a bite. And it just more, it's like so much food just for a nibble. A half a year's wages, or more than a half a year's wages, it was 200 denarii. A day's wage was one denarii, so 200 days is what he's talking about. It wouldn't be enough for everyone, but just to have a bite. And then another disciple, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, he spoke up and he said, hey, wait a minute. There's this kid here, a boy, with five small barley loaves and two small fish, but how far will they go among so many? How far? How far would that go with us? And so Jesus has in mind what he's going to do. He's testing his disciples. He sent them out into the crowd. Another gospel writer tells us he sent out, say, okay, go see what your supplies are. And so for Philip, it was a money question. Where are you going to get the money to buy food for all these people? Where are we going to buy it? Where's the location? Where's it going to come from? How are we going to pay for it? For Andrew, it is resources. We have a few resources, but we don't have a lot. It's not going to put a dent in this. And really, we're going to still, the only person in this whole group of 20,000 people that was smart enough to think ahead and bring lunch, including the disciples, was this little boy. So we're going to hijack his lunch and take it and let everyone else fight for it, right? That's going to be a frenzy. It's not going to work. And so that's what's going on. There's this boy. And let's go on. I think let's keep going here. There we go. This is the point. To let Jesus all in me, I must change my solution. I must change my solution. Change what I'm looking for. Change what I think is going to satisfy me. Change what I believe is the right solution. Because all of the solutions that we provide are normally worldly. They're normally what we can accomplish. They're normally the resources that we have. A lot of times we don't do the things that Christ has called us to because maybe our pockets are empty and we don't have finances, or maybe we don't know what to do, and so we never take the first step. We never take the first step in with Him, and because we think, I don't have the solution. Of course you don't have the solution. The whole point of Jesus is that none of us have the solution for anything. Even what we have, God provides. He says He causes to rain on the just and the unjust. Every single person, even the most hardened atheist and the hardened skeptic, everything they have is because of what Christ has blessed them with and given them. And He wants them to see that. He wants them to see that's a blessing. We got to go to Jesus first, to trust Him first. Not my phone, not my bank account, not how much room's left on my credit card, not the next job opportunity, not the other options. What we do is we explore our options, we find out what we can do, and then we ask Jesus to bless that, to come and join us in what we're actually capable of doing. What Jesus calls us to do is to see Him as the solution and come and join Him in what He is doing. There's a different solution to everything we're looking for. Everything. Physically, spiritually, emotionally, relationally, mentally, everything, there is a different solution. And that is indeed Jesus. Go down to verse 28 and 29. He says, then they asked him. Okay, so here's what's going on. The last question, remember, they said, Jesus said, work for food that doesn't spoil, work for food that endures to eternal life. And so now this is the next thing they say. Well, what must we do to do the works that God requires? So they understand he's talking spiritually. They understand that he's using food as a spiritual thing because they know that, hey, we're talking about what God requires. And so what work does God want you to do? That's what they're asking. What work does God want me to do? What does he require of me? How is it that I work for this food that doesn't spoil? How is it that I work for the satisfaction that endures into eternal life? It lasts forever. How is it? And Jesus answers. And this is what he says. The work of God is this. What is it? To believe in the one he sent. Powerful? Stop working. These are rule followers. These are people who are they're trying to achieve godliness by working their way to God. They're trying to do good works to win God's favor. We talked about that last week. It's really superstition. If you believe that you can control the spirits by your action or inaction, that's superstition. It's not of God, it's of Satan. That's actually what they've been doing. That's what they had become. And there's every other religion in the world is that. It is that. Trying to appease a God so that you can win favor and do enough works to somehow warrant his eternal life, his forgiveness. And Jesus says, this is it. Believe in the one he sent. That's it. Who did he send? Jesus, the Son of Man, the Messiah, the Christ, the Son of God, to believe that Jesus is him. The solution is submission to God, to Jesus Christ. In Deuteronomy chapter 5, you'll recognize this, the Ten Commandments. God says, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of slavery, or out of the Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You should have no other gods before me. And see, when we look for other solutions, when we look to physical bread, the bread that spoils, when we look to money and bank accounts, and we look to education and status and popularity, and we look to the American dream, when we look to all of that, we have other gods before him. I have other gods. I'm an idolater. The good news is that the number one sin that God forgives is idolatry, because every sin falls underneath that category. That's why that is number one. To love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and strength. Have no other gods before him. And right now, we're at a time, and look, this is not political, so if you hear it political, please forgive me. But we're at a time where most people that I know, regardless of where they are on the political spectrum, are worried about the country. Some of them are worried for different reasons, but everyone's worried about the country. And there's this fear that's taken over people. We've got this virus going on. We've got this election going on. We don't know what's true and what's not. We've got media. It depends on what TV channel you turn on to. You're hearing different things. And everyone's kind of afraid. We're kind of worried. Why are we worried? Why are we worried? Because our safety, our systems, our schools with COVID, our government, it's falling apart. And we're worried. We're afraid. Why are we afraid? Why are you afraid? And every one of us have a little angst in us, right? Everyone? A little? You admit it? A little bit of angst? Why is that? It's because I've been trusting in the USA, not in Jesus. I've been building my hope on the American dream, not in Jesus. And so have you. And Jesus says, come all into me and I'll give you everything. Come into me. And when we build our hope on everything, we sing that song. build our hope on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. And when we build our hope on temporal things, Jesus has promised the world is passing away and so is the things of the world. Do not love the world, love him instead. It's all passing away. None of us are guaranteed. And it's a hard transition to make when you've been depending upon and relying upon the fruits of our hand and the blessings of our nation and our government and our safety and our schools and all of these things to kind of really impose some sort of moral character and fiber into the community when we should have been relying upon Jesus and what he says. Because there's a constitution that's greater than the United States Constitution. Do we know that? And there is a court that's higher than the Supreme Court of the United States of America. And that's where Jesus is, as the Son of Man, with all dominion, all authority. And this life is not all there is. He calls us to live by faith, not by sight, because everything that you see is passing away. That's a hard pill for people to swallow. But look, it's true. We're all going to die, rich or poor. We all have the same problem. That's why everything in the world shut down over COVID, because everyone's afraid to die. No one wants to die. That's the problem. They're all trying to fix it. They're looking for vaccines. There is a vaccine. His name is Jesus. And he heals everything. Because if you're in him, you're going to live forever with him. The third point this morning is this. To let Jesus all in me, I must obey him. I must obey him. Like if I really want to be all in for Jesus, if I say he is my Lord, he is my Son of Man, he is the one, if I believe that he is the Messiah, the Christ, the Son of God, the kind of belief that we're talking about, and all we're trying to do here is redefine what belief means. We're redefining what belief means. Belief means all in. I must obey him. Because I can't say I believe you're the king, the God, the solution, the one, the creator, the one who's made everything, and then, oh yeah, I'm not going to listen to you. Like, how stupid is that? But that's what I do. That's what we do. We don't obey. We actually think obeying is learning more about him. Our churches are full of people. We're learners, and we should be. We're supposed to learn Scripture. All Scripture is profitable. It's God-breathed, it's profitable for rebuke, for training, for instructions in righteousness and godliness. It's God-breathed, it's inspired. But Jesus is the Word. Jesus is the Word of God. That's how this whole book of John started out. He is the Word. He is the one who spoke the world into existence. He is the Creator. And going all in means I go all in to obeying him. If I want all of him in me, I've got to listen and do what he's calling me to do. Otherwise, I'm holding him out. In verses 10 through 11, John chapter 6, he says, Jesus said, have the people sit down. There's plenty of grass in that place. And they sat down. About 5,000 men were there. They obeyed. How crazy would that be? Imagine me going to Papa John's Stadium or wherever it is they play football, and saying, hey guys, listen, and let's say you guys are with me, all right? And they're out of concessions, just completely out. They can't serve any. Okay, listen, here's what we're going to do. There's 70,000 people here. I don't know how many holds. Let's get everybody in groups of 50 or 100. And then I did happen to bring a hot dog with me, and so just go ahead and get everyone, just go out there and get them all set down and then come back and we'll take care of this. You would be like, dude, I'm going home, right? You wouldn't do it. But they obeyed. They knew. They knew Jesus was going to do something. They've seen him heal. They didn't know what he was going to do yet, because this miracle is so different than any other miracle. This miracle actually was participated in by over 5,000 people, probably 20, 25,000 people. No other miracle got this kind of sight or fanfare. No other miracle is actually what he's going to do here other than the feeding of the 4,000 that he did. But this still trumps even that one there. They obeyed. They obeyed what he said to do. Obeying Jesus is doing what he says to do, not learning more about him. We believe in the American church, in the Enlightenment period, that we have received this from 200 years, 300 years of Enlightenment thinking, that we can educate ourselves into a relationship with Christ. And learning more about him is actually obeying him. But it's not. It's important. It's vitally important. It's even vitally important to an ongoing walk, and we've already talked about it. But we just don't obey. He said, have them sit down, and then this. Jesus then took the loaves, and he gave thanks, and he distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted, and then he did the same with the fish. This is a creation event. This is a creation miracle. He's creating fish and bread. It's just coming. Look. What's this? As much as they wanted. Now, I don't know about you. I love crackers. And when Emily brings them in the house, the Ritz, especially, everything's better sitting on a Ritz, right? Man, I can eat the whole package. The whole sleeve, and it's just like, gone. I'm looking for another. It's like, it's a weakness of mine. It's like, John MacArthur talks about this. He says, these are pre-fall fish and pre-fall bread. This has got to be the best tasting bread and the best tasting fish ever because it's not tainted by sin. It's created immediately by Christ. Created on the spot. It had to taste so good. And so they ate it as much as they wanted. There's an abundance here. There's a provision here. And when you talk about the kind of people that were there, how much had to be made. You just think about how lavish God's love is on you, how much he cares about you, how much he's telling you the truth about things, that you can believe him, that you can trust him, you can obey him. And so the people sat down. They don't know where the fish is coming from. Like, Jesus is over there creating fish on the hillside, and they're bringing it down and serving it to the people. That would have taken some time too, wouldn't it? This isn't like David Blaine making the Statue of Liberty disappear for a few minutes. This would have taken some time to distribute all of that food. And he didn't make baby fish and let them grow into a big fish. He didn't take yeast or even flour and cook it and turn it immediate, full, mature fish, mature bread to eat on the spot. Instantly for everyone who needed, for everyone to get as much as they wanted. Down in verses number 33 through 35 of the same chapter, Jesus says this, for the bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. So this bread, this miracle, this abundance, this over provision for everyone as much as they had need is pointing to the bread that comes down from heaven. Now, these people get confused. They think, are you Moses? Are you better than Moses? Moses gave us manna. And Jesus is like, no, this is it. And he goes on. They say, sir, give us this bread. Always give us this bread. And then this is where Jesus makes this great statement. In the next verse, he says, I am the bread of life. Me. I'm the only, if you come into this world and you never get anything, you need him. You live in poverty, you die too soon, or you come with everything in the world. It doesn't matter. You need him. He is the bread. Whoever comes to me, he says, will never go hungry. And whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. It's just like he told the woman at the well. The difference being that the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman at the well, she believed instantly. She went and got her townspeople. They came. They listened to Jesus. And there was a revival broke out. These people here are religious people. And Jesus has got to use 71 verses here. Or John uses 71 verses outside of the walking on the water story we'll talk about next week. To try to explain to these people. But they're blinded. They can't see. These are the religious folks. Whoever comes to me. Look at that. Whoever comes to me, they're never. What does come mean? What does it mean to come? It means to follow. It means to believe. Come means to believe in him. It means to come to him for what you need. He is, the solution. You're obeying him because he says, come to me if you're thirsty. Come to me if you're hungry. Come to me, all you who are labored and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Come to me. Get what you need from me. Get your satisfaction. Get everything, your goal. Get it from me. Because I'm the true bread, he says. This brings up a principle. That's this. It is as you obey Jesus that he works in you and through you. A lot of people are looking for Jesus to work in them and even start ministries through them, but they've yet to obey. They're wanting God to do the miraculous in their lives and in the lives of people around them, which is a good desire, but they're not obeying. There's areas in their life where they just say no to God. And you can't do that. It's as you obey. It's as you become a disciple. As you become the disciple, you obey. And so every single one of us anew. I believe this is what real revival is. Revival is when Christian people stop believing that we know everything and that we've got everything down, and we start putting ourselves into the position of a disciple, as someone who's hungry to feed on Jesus and to obey him and to live out his purposes in our lives and in this world. That's what it's become, a disciple. My job is not to be someone who teaches everyone everything, but it's to be a disciple. And as I obey him in my life, he gives me opportunities to share with others, opportunities to see people come to Christ, opportunities to share and stand. But it's as you obey that happens. And a lot of people are waiting for things to happen, and then they will obey, and it doesn't work that way. As you obey. In verse number 38, Jesus says, "For I've come down from heaven, not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me." Even Jesus obeyed the Father. We don't like the word obey. It's oppressive. It's ugly. It brings up abuse situations. Jesus is like, obey me, because I'm obeying the Father. If we're following Jesus, we're obeying too. You can't follow and not obey. You can't. You can. You can say you believe in him, but you really don't believe all in belief, saving belief, biblical belief. And there's areas in my life where I'm still holding him at arm's length, and I'm like, Lord, penetrate that hardness. Convict me of that. Bring me to you. Another principle. He says, there is nothing I can do that will satisfy my hungry soul as trusting and obeying Jesus does. If I want satisfaction, if I want to feel fulfilled, if I want purpose, like who doesn't want purpose? Like at some point we all say, well, yeah, purpose, we all want that. That's the easy one. But if I want that, if I want satisfaction out of this life, if I want to be laying on my deathbed and be satisfied with my life, then it comes through obeying, trusting in and obeying Jesus, not in pursuing all the things that Tony wants to pursue and all the things that the world tells me to pursue and all the things that other people tell me to pursue. And many of us are living our lives under the expectations of other people rather than of Jesus. And it makes us miserable. We're faking it. We're trying to live up to other people's standards for us. The whole point of Jesus is that you cannot live up to any standard, but he is the standard. He's lived up to it, and he will give you his qualification. And he does, if you come to him. The fourth point. To let Jesus all in me, I must fill myself with him. I must fill myself. Look at verses 12 and 13. When they had all had enough to eat, he said to his disciples, "Gather the pieces that are left over. Let nothing be wasted." Is there going to be any left? All right, here we go. So they gathered them, and they filled 12 baskets with the pieces of the 5 barley loaves left over by those who had eaten. Why were these guys on the hill to begin with? They were hungry. They needed a rest. They needed a recharge. They obeyed. They trusted. They did everything Christ told them to do. And they watched him have compassion and minister to other people. That's obeying. And what happened was he gave them all their own basket of food. He provided. They're going to get their fill of what to eat. They're going to get their fill. They all got to go home. That's provision. Verses 53 and 56 is what this points to. Jesus said to them, "Verily, verily, I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you." You must be filled with him, filled with his spirit, filled. You've consumed him. There's no other way to say this. We understand consuming food, how much we need it, how satisfying it is. Jesus is like, same thing with me. He's not talking about cannibalism. Next verse, he says, "Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day." That's why we do the Lord's Supper. It's a reminder of his broken body, his flesh, and his blood that was spilt so he could redeem us, so he could pay the penalty we had for sin, so that he could restore us to proper relationship with the Father, so that we could enter his kingdom and start moving and being in him and helping this place see glimpses of the Father and what the kingdom is going to ultimately be like one day. We're a little outpost of that. And he says, you need that. That's the satisfaction you're looking for. It's a reminder. And this, the next verse, "For my flesh is real food and my blood is real drink." You want satisfaction, you've got to feed on him. Obey him, trust him. Look to him for he's your solution, your provision. The world and its desires are passing away. America may bounce back. We've been through this before. But if this tragedy in our generation causes us to stop being idolaters and start looking to him rather than the American dream, then thank God for the tragedy. Right? Because I've allowed my pursuit of the American dream to be my God, to be what I rely on, to be what fulfills me, to be my goal in life. That is it. The little white house, the little picket fence, and retirement one day, and the grandkids, and all the money, that and the lake, and the jet skis. Oh, yeah, I'll be happy. It's all going to go away. What will make you happy in eternity is a relationship with the Father through Christ the Son, living in a new heaven and a new earth, enjoying what's not tainted by sin. Verse 53, did I repeat this, I believe? Let's go on to verse 66. It says, "From this time on, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him." All those people, 20,000, 5,000, pick your number, many of them turned and left and no longer followed. Why? Because they were looking for temporal fixes, temporal solutions. They were not looking to give their allegiance and their life to a new king. They were looking to fix their problems and let life go better now. That's why Christianity is really a suburban religion. It shouldn't be. We want him to fix our problems. Help us. And he does. But we still have our allegiance in the other ground. The next verse. Jesus says to the 12, "Do you want to leave too?" He just turns around. You know how we we try to make everybody happy and we don't want anyone to leave. We compromise our mission and we compromise our vision and we compromise what Christ is calling us to do because we don't want to scare anybody. We don't want to run anybody off. And Jesus is like, look, this is the deal. Either I'm your king or I'm not. You're either going to find everything in me or you're not. There's the door. What? Simon Peter. Simon Peter, the one that normally sticks his foot in his mouth, but thank God he's made a couple of phenomenal observations. Here's what he says. Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Where else you going to go? This life is but a vapor and it's gone. Gone. Where are you going to be in eternity? This is what he says. We have come to believe and to know that you are the Holy One of God. That's, how do we come to know that? How do we come to believe that? That is he pulling you? Is he drawing you? Is he showing you that the pursuits of this world, it's important to have a job. I'm not saying go quit your job. It's the pursuits and our reliance upon what this world offers that makes this world our God, makes ourselves and our ambitions our God, not God our God. And Jesus is the Holy One. He is the One. And that brings us back to the main point. To go all in with Jesus, I must let Jesus go all into me. Are you ready? Do you want to go all in? You've got the card on your seat. You've got when you come in. If you're new here, I'll explain it. If not, then you know exactly what you need to do. Put your name on that card. If we don't have your email address, put your email address on there. Please print so we can understand who's writing. And here's your options. One, you say, I'm ready to go all in. Yeah, you sense the Holy Spirit is drawing you and showing you what all in this is, and he's giving you at least one area of your life that you can submit and surrender to him, maybe an idol that you've had that you've been serving. Maybe you've been making other people serve that, and it's not bringing you any satisfaction. Can we sing that song, I Can't Get No Satisfaction? I could do it. You would leave. I'm ready to go all in. You might not know exactly what that looks like, and you're like, I have questions about it. Mark that if that's your, or say, I'm already all in. And if you're watching online or you know, you're watching later, you can go to bbclife.org/all in and let us know what God's doing in your life. And it's going to be different for everyone, but everyone has a next step with him. Let's pray. Father, today, Lord, rather than just walking out of here in a few moments, pray, Lord, that we would indeed, Lord, all of us are thinking about food. Let us think about you. Let us go all in to you, Christ. I pray that every person here who's struggling, who's having issues, who's, Lord, maybe they're here and they just want you to help their relationships. And Lord, you have compassion on them and you'll do what you can to help them in their relationships. Maybe they're having financial difficulties, Lord, and you care about that. And you want people to be good stewards. And Lord, maybe they have addictions. And Lord, you don't want us to be addicted to anything but to you. And so, Lord, maybe there's those things that are going on. Maybe there's relationships that are falling apart in their lives and they really need your help in that. Maybe it's with their families. Maybe it's just with school. Whatever it happens to be, Father. And you help with that. But Lord, let us come to you for you. Because you are the Son of Man, the Son of God, the Messiah, the only one from God. Let us, Lord, show us how. Bring up these idols of our heart. And Lord, help us lay them down at your altar and accept you as our only God. I pray that you would move in our lives, individually, Lord, and also collectively. And it's in the name, the powerful name, the risen Savior's name, Jesus Christ, that we pray. Amen. Let's all stand as we prepare to sing. And when you get done marking your card, you can just leave that on your chair when you leave, and we'll collect it.
My bonded sorrow and night, Jesus, I come, Jesus, I come. Into thy freedom, gladness and light, Jesus, I come to thee. And out of my sickness and into thy health, and out of my want and into thy wealth, out of my sin and into thyself, Jesus, I come to thee.
As we close today our gathering, I want to thank you for being here again. Thank you, those who are viewing today online. It means so much that you've tuned in with your time and your presence today. The Spirit is with us, because Jesus is alive. Amen?
Amen.
And the Spirit's going to do a lot with today's worship, today's experience of just listening to the Scriptures being unpackaged for us today as we've been tuned into His Word. He is going to do great things. Let's just be open and flexible to what He's doing inside as we learn to follow Him, as we learn to go all in, that believing is all in. To be reminded of that and take the steps that have been laid out before us today. I see some with masks on. Just like to ask you all to get all of those out as we prepare to move around the room. And it looks like we might have some sunshine. So don't go away too quickly without saying hey to somebody as you make your way out. Once again, let the usher come and get you from your seat this morning. Fill out the Connect card if you haven't done so yet. We want to connect with you in that way. Can't remind you enough about that. God bless you. You're all dismissed today.